Tamil Nadu, we would like to introduce our today's speaker. We have two wonderful speakers. Already you have experienced the teaching experience of Dr. Dinakar sir, and to add to that, we have a wonderful human being, a wonderful, very knowledgeful person, and who has done lots of work in neonatal echo, Dr. Ramakrishnan. He is a chief consultant at SKS Hospital Salem. We would like to thank Kamal sir for the opportunity. Now I request Ramakrishnan Ram to start the session. Over to you, Ram.
Thank you, Prashant sir. Thanks for the very nice introduction. I am very humbled, and thank you very much for the organizing team for providing me an opportunity to talk in front of you. So is it okay if I wear my mask? Can you hear my voice clearly? Okay.
Yes.
So what
yes.
I will
yes.
do is I will start off with hands direct. The baby is here, calm and quiet, and I will start off with the hands direct demonstration. One second, madam. Latika, madam, inga. Okay. So what? So this is the baby who is lying here, and I have the echo machine positioned. So inge idu pannumbodhu other focus pannuvom inge idu pannumbodhu okay. So what with congenital heart disease, my topic is identifying congenital heart disease, right? So I think the best way to go about it is to be very systematic, and only then you will be able to pick up the congenital heart disease. So what I'll do, I'll just go from the subcostal view. For the subcostal view, so this is the probe, right? The depression or the groove on the probe should be onto the right side, and we have to place the probe first, in this angle, right? So the moment you place the probe, what you will see, once you place the probe, you will see the one here is the probe coming. So once I place the probe, you will see three. This is the stomach bubble here, right? And then you will see the IVC, the aorta, and the spine. So you will see the IVC here, aorta here, and the stomach here, right? Am I pointing out correctly? Okay. So then what you do, you have to make sure that the IVC is connected to the right atrium, right? So okay. So the IVC is connected to the right atrium. So you turn the right. So now what is, you can see this hole is getting connected to the right atrium here. Right? So this IVC is, you have established that the IVC is connected to the right atrium. And then below that, if you turn the probe, so when I first placed, I kept it like this. And then when I turned it around, so what I do is you place it like this, and then turn it 90 degree, and then tilt it this side to see the IVC, and tilt it this side to see the aorta. So this is the cross-sectional view, and this is the longitudinal view. So first, you place it cross-sectional like this, and then you see your IVC here, the pulsatile aorta here, and the spine here. And then you have your stomach in the left-hand corner. And then you show this. So from this position, I'm tilting the probe. I'm turning around the probe to 90 degrees. Show here. So this is the IVC, which is getting connected there. And then the aorta, right? The pulsatile aorta. Now, in this situation to identify some congenital heart disease, if you apply color here, you can see the hepatic vein flowing into the connecting to the IVC, and also you should demonstrate some flow in the IVC, and you should be able to see the aorta. You can see the pulsatile flow in the aorta. So only these things you will be able to see in this view, right? You will be able to see the IVC, hepatic vein, and the pulsatile flow in the aorta. If you are able to, if you see any other vessel, you know, a big chunky vessel, I will show you in my PowerPoint presentation. So in this view, if you see any other chunky vessel, then you have to suspect whether there is an intracardiac TAPVC. So this baby just has the IVC, hepatic vein, and the aorta here. Nothing else is coming there. So this is one view, initial view to assess whether there is any major defect, right? And again, in this view, right, this is the spine. The bottom posterior aspect is the spine. And the one here, that is your IVC. This is the aorta. Now, the IVC should be anterior and to the right of the spine, whereas the aorta should be posterior, bit inferior to the IVC and to the left of the spine. So this arrangement you need to maintain. You should make sure that this arrangement is there to ensure that the atrium is situs, right? Atria, right atria and left atria are connected properly. You need that one to discuss. So this is your first view. In this view, make sure that the IVC is connected to the right atrium, and then the aorta comes there. There should be no vessels in between, right? And if you apply color Doppler there, only you should be able to see the pulsatile aorta flow, and then the IVC and the hepatic vein flow. So this is one view. If you find any other vessel, you suspect TAPVC, I'll show you in my video. And the next one in the same subcostal view, right? You just, so the heart is located here. So you just place the probe like this, right? And then tilt the probe, so you will be able to see the heart. See here, you can see that you are able to see two chambers. This one is the right atrium, this one is the left atrium. And what you see in between is the interatrial septum. Now, if you look at the interatrial septum, you can see a flap that is coming in between, right? That is your foramen ovale. You can see something that is wobbly, like a flap. See, now it's opening. Now the flap is closing, right? And this is exactly in the middle of the septum. So whatever you find in the middle of the atrial septum with a flap, it is most likely to be a patent foramen ovale. If that is not in the middle of the septum, say, if it's not in the middle of the septum, if it's in the lower end of the septum or in the upper end of the septum, then it is an atrial septal defect. So the location of the interatrial communication is important to differentiate whether it's an atrial septal defect or a patent foramen ovale. So something on top or the bottom. If it's in the bottom, you call it as, if the gap is in the bottom of the atrial septum, you call it as the primum atrial septal defect. If it's in the top, it's called as a sinus venosus atrial septal defect. Whereas in the middle, most likely it's patent foramen ovale. But if there is no flap, if this flap is not visible, you call it as a secundum atrial septal defect, right? So if you apply color Doppler to this, whenever you see a gap, you need to see which direction the flow is coming. So if you apply the color Doppler, right, what will happen is, you can see this baby was born only yesterday. So you can see there is some red flow. See, there is some red flow here, and also there is some blue flow. You can see there is some blue flow there, and there is some red flow. So which means the blood is flowing in both directions from here. The blood is flowing from the left atrium to the right atrium, and also from the right atrium to the... So this baby has a little bit of bidirectional shunt, which is an expected finding for age. Okay? Because the baby was born only yesterday. So there is a small PFO here with bidirectional shunt. The direction of shunt is important because if it's pure right to left shunt, that is dangerous. Because pure right to left shunt, you will see in total anomalous pulmonary venous drainage and all those things. There should be some amount of bidirectional flow going through that, or left to right, which is normal. Okay. So now you have looked at the subcostal view. And in the subcostal view, you also see the superior vena cava. So what happens is this red flow. You can see a red flow coming from the top. I will freeze it and show you. So this flow coming from the top is your superior vena cava flow, because the right atrium is here, the interatrial septum is here, the left atrium is there, right? So that is your superior vena cava flow. And in this view, you will be able to see two pulmonary veins draining into the left atrium. So I will see if I can show that. This baby does not have good echo window, so I will see if I can show it in some other baby. But in this view, it's difficult to... one second, I'll see. Okay. So you can see this red flow on the left side. That is one pulmonary vein coming into the left atrium. See this red flow. This red flow is one pulmonary vein coming into the left atrium. And the other one, if you concentrate in this angle, you will see the other red flow as well. So in this view, you should be able to see at least two pulmonary veins coming into the left atrium. If you're able to see two veins, then it rules out total anomalous pulmonary venous drainage. But you still have to look at the other views to confirm for any partial anomalous pulmonary venous drainage, right? So this, you can see one flow here, one flow here, that is your pulmonary venous drainage. Okay, so subcostal view, these are the things that you... There is also something you do bicaval, you know, you see, look at both the SVC and the IVC. I will see if I can get that. So this is your... I don't want to press the baby's abdomen too long, because I don't want the baby to cry now and spoil the echo. What I'll do, I'll show the bicaval view at the end. Okay. So following the apical view, you go to the... following the subcostal view, you go to the apical view. So the apical view, so you know the heart is there. And this marker should be on the right side, and you place it on the apex of the baby, and this is what you get, right? So you see the right atrium, the left atrium, the right ventricle, and the left ventricle, right? So, and you can see the tricuspid valve, which is opening, and the mitral valve, which is opening. Now, in this view, you have to concentrate on the tricuspid and the mitral valve. The free end of the tricuspid valve you know, this opening end should be towards the septal side and the fixed end should be to the lateral side. Only then you can call it as a mitral valve, sorry, tricuspid valve. If it's the other way around, it is not a, tricuspid valve. Whereas the mitral valve, if you concentrate on the mitral valve, the free end should be opening towards the lateral wall of the left ventricle and the fixed end should be attached to the septum. Correctly corrected transposition. So here it looks okay. So which means the tricuspid valve is attached to the right ventricle. Tricuspid valve is on the right side and the mitral valve is on the left side. So this information you get from this view, apical view. And you can also see the ventricular septum in this view. And this is one view to look for any VSD. If you apply color, and if you find any blood crossing across the septum, interventricular septum, you call it as a VSD. Now, so this is the septum. I'll zoom it a little bit. So this is the interventricular septum, right? And if you apply the color and reduce the box, if you find any blood crossing across the septum, you call it as VSD. And the position of the VSD, you have to decide whether it's a muscular VSD or a membranous VSD or an apical VSD. So if it's somewhere in the top, it's called a membranous VSD, perimembranous VSD. In the middle of the septum, you get muscular VSD. And at the bottom, very bottom, at the apex, you call the apical VSD. So location of the VSD is very, very important in deciding which type. And for VSD, this image alone will not be sufficient. You have to tilt the probe. You have to tilt the probe up and down to see the location of the VSD. So here, if you see, if I tilt the probe up, you will see the left ventricle coming out, right? That's the left ventricular outflow tract. And this is the ventricular septum. And if you should concentrate on any flow across the septum in this view as well, because certain types of VSDs you will be able to see here, right? So, and then you go till the apex. So you keep tilting the probe forward and backward and go till the apex of the screen to look for any VSD, right? In this baby, I can't see any VSD in this view, but you have to confirm it in other views as well, which I will show you later. So this is your apical four-chamber view. And then you tilt further, you get the left ventricular outflow tract. This is the, you see the, and then tilt further and further and further, you also get the right ventricular outflow tract. So the first thing that you get is left ventricular outflow tract. The next thing you get is right ventricular outflow tract. Now, I'll show you the probe position. So this is the first position. Then you tilt further, you get the left ventricular outflow tract. And then tilt further and further, you get the right ventricular outflow tract. So this sweep. So this sweep you get. Now, say for example, when you're tilting further, the first I told you should be is your left ventricular outflow tract. If you don't get this, and if you get this one in this direction, then you have to suspect whether there is a TGA, because the left ventricular outflow tract should arise from the aorta, should arise from the left ventricle, and the pulmonary artery from the right ventricle. But in TGA, you will get the reverse of that, which you can get a clue from this side. Okay? So this view is good for looking at the VSD. This view is good for looking at the transposition, right? And also looking for any congenital corrected transposition, right? Not only that, you have to apply color Doppler to this. And if there is any tricuspid regurgitation, you will be able to see. So you can see the red flow from the right atrium to the right ventricle because the probe is here. The blood is flowing from the right atrium to the right ventricle. So it's red in color. Any significant blue color means there is tricuspid regurgitation. This baby does not have significant tricuspid regurgitation, but has little bit of a flash intermittently, right? And similarly, the mitral valve, mitral input, you have to measure that. And you have to see whether there is any mitral stenosis or mitral tricuspid stenosis, mitral regurgitation, tricuspid regurgitation in this view. Now to look at the stenosis, what you do is you apply color and then place the pulsed wave Doppler gate just in the area of the tricuspid valve or just below. And then you get your E and A waves, right? So this is the tricuspid inflow. And if you calculate the peak velocities, you know, it should be only 0.5 meters per second. If anything is significant, if it's more than 2 meters per second or something, you suspect whether there's a stenosis or if there is any turbulence in the red flow. See, now this red flow is beautiful. There is no turbulence. But if there is any turbulence in this area, you suspect tricuspid stenosis or mitral stenosis. And if there is any regurgitation, you will find a blue flow. But here there is only intermittently, I'm seeing a flash of blue flow here on the tricuspid valve. And there is no blue flow on the mitral valve. So there is no mitral regurgitation. Whereas there is some tricuspid regurgitation intermittently, you can see on the tricuspid valve, there is a flash. Okay. So this apical four-chamber view is good to look at the VSD, good to look at tricuspid regurgitation, good to look at congenitally corrected transposition. It's good to look at TGA to see whether there is any, alteration of the great vessels, right? So this is the apical view, right? The next one I'm going to do is the parasternal view. So this is your parasternal long axis view. Here you need to invert the screen. And I will freeze this image after zooming it. So this is your parasternal long axis view. And the way you get it is by placing the probe. So this groove should face the right shoulder of the baby. And it should be, because the heart is in this direction, the probe should be placed in, should be towards the right shoulder, and just place it centrally. And any view, you have to tilt it forward up, tilt a little bit downward, you get the entire parasternal long axis view, right? So I'm going to the midline, you know, the middle parasternal long axis view, and this is what you get. So here, this big structure here is the left atrium. This is the left ventricle. And this is the mitral valve here. This tube is the aorta with the aortic valve in the center. And the one on top is your right ventricle. Okay, so this is your parasternal long axis view. Now, what is the purpose of this view? Now, this view, you can see that the cent, you know, in this tube, there is one white structure going in, and see now that white structure has disappeared, and this white structure has come in now. This, if you concentrate here, right? So the white structure has disappeared, that white structure has come in. So that's the aortic valve closing and opening in systole and diastole, right? And in this view, you are able to see only the aortic valve, aortic outflow tract, sorry, left ventricular outflow tract. The right ventricle outflow tract you cannot see in this view, right? But in transposition of great arteries, if you see another vessel like this on top with the white structure where the valve is opening and closing, we call it as a parallel arrangement of vessels. So this parallel arrangement of vessels, if you see that, you suspect whether there is a transposition of great arteries, right? So this is your parasternal long axis view. One benefit of that is to look for any TGA, right? And the other thing, in the parasternal long axis view, you can also look for VSD. I will freeze the video and show you. So this entire thing is this interventricular septum, because below that is the left ventricle, on top is your right ventricle, and in the middle is the interventricular septum. And if you apply color Doppler, right, see this blue flow is the aorta flow, right, and this flow here is the left atrium draining into the left ventricle. But if you look, there is no flow from the right ventricle to the left ventricle. If there is a VSD, you will see a flow from the right ventricle to the left ventricle, right? I will show this in the videos of congenital heart disease, right? If there is a VSD, you have to go through till the end. You have to go through till the end, make sure that there is no apical VSD. So reduce the color window a little bit, and then you screen like this. You get the entire ventricular septum and screen across to see if there is any VSD. So there is no VSD in this baby. And then what you do, you tilt the probe upward. So I told you this is the midline parasternal, and then you tilt the probe upward. When you tilt the probe upward, what you will see here is, you will see the pulmonary artery. So the left ventricle and other things have disappeared now. Now you are seeing the main pulmonary artery here. This is the pulmonary valve, right? So, and if you put color Doppler there, you can see beautiful laminar flow of pulmonary artery flow. And if there is any turbulence, you suspect pulmonary stenosis. And always you check the color Doppler. Press the color Doppler. Right? And this maximum velocity should not cross 200 centimeters per square centimeter. Sorry, 200 centimeter per second or 2 meters per second. It should not cross beyond that. If it crosses beyond that, then you suspect whether there is a pulmonary stenosis, right? So this is your parasternal long axis view with a little bit of upward tilt. On the same parasternal long axis view, if you tilt it down, right, this is what you see. If you tilt it down, you will see the right atrium here, and this is the tricuspid valve on the right ventricle. Right, and this is used to check for your tricuspid regurgitation. Any tricuspid regurgitation you can see in this view. As I told you, this baby does not have significant tricuspid regurgitation. Although the baby was born only yesterday, there is no significant tricuspid regurgitation, only intermittent flash is seen. Okay, so this is the usefulness of this view. In this view, you know, in the functional echocardiography, you will learn that, you know, the M mode, the fractional shortening and all those things can be calculated. I don't want to go into details because somebody will deal with that. I am concentrating only on critical congenital heart disease. So to parasternal long axis view, if you see any parallel vessel arrangement, you suspect transposition of great arteries. you look for VSD in this view, right? And you look for any tractor speed regurgitation, assess the aortic valve, whether it's opening and closing, whether there is any stenosis, whether there is any restricted aortic flow. Sometimes in left ventricular sort of hypoplastic left heart, you will see that the aorta is very, very small. See, this is the normal size of an aorta. But in hypoplastic left heart syndrome, in this view, you will see that the ascending aorta or the origin of the aorta is very, very small. Okay. And then I will come to the parasternal short axis view. So in the same area, so previously you kept the probe like this. So rotate the probe so that this one, this ridge, faces your left shoulder, baby's left shoulder. And once you do that, you will see that you can see the aortic valve in the center. Right, the center round structure is your aortic valve, and this is your main pulmonary artery. Right, so this is your left atrium. You have your interatrial septum, right? Right atrium, right ventricle, and your pulmonary artery. So it comes like that. And you see the Mercedes-Benz sign with the trileaflet aortic valve. So you can see there is this horizontal leaflet here and this one vertical leaflet. So this is a trileaflet Mercedes-Benz sign, like sort of sign. And you can see the assess the pulmonary artery in this view also, right? And you can check the velocity of the pulmonary artery in this view also. See, ideally the pulmonary flow should be bullet shaped, but because this baby was born only yesterday, there is some amount of pulmonary hypertension, so it will be narrow, but the velocity should not be more than 200 centimeters per second or 2 meters per second, right? And then in the same view, if you apply the color Doppler around the aorta, aortic valve, right, you can see that there is no flow across. Say, for example, if there is a perimembranous VSD, right, what will happen is you will see that the blood is flowing from this area to the right ventricle, right? So there will be flow across this area, across this area. So if you see those sort of findings, you suspect whether there is a VSD. But here, there is no blood flow, you know, across this valve ring, and you can see only it is flowing around, you know, in the right ventricle and in the right ventricular outflow tract. So this is one view where you look for any VSDs, and you can also assess the right ventricular outflow tract. And then from the same pulmonary artery, sorry, parasternal short axis view, you tilt the probe a little bit towards the apex, right, like this. So gentle tilting this way and gentle tilting upward. So if you tilt towards the apex, what you will see is you will see the left ventricle here, interventricular septum, and your right ventricle. Okay. And then in this view also, you can look for any VSD if you apply color Doppler. If you apply color Doppler, you should be able to see any flow across if there is a apical VSD, but there is no flow, so there is no VSD. And you can see the papillary muscles of the left ventricle, right? So this confirms that these two papillary muscles, if you find, then it confirms that this is definitely the left ventricle and not the right ventricle. So if the ventricles are all reversely connected, you will not find these papillary muscles here, right? And this is the apex, completely to the apex. And before the papillary muscles, you will get the mitral valve. You will get a fish-mouthed mitral valve. That also shows that this baby, the left ventricle is, so you can see a fish-mouthed mitral valve, and then you see the papillary muscles, right? So Right. So that's so you see the, I'll show if I can see if I can get better images in another baby. Okay. So this is your parastinal short axis, and then you go upward. You tilt the probe up and see the here you can see the right coronary artery. So the right coronary artery is coming and connecting to the aortic ring, rim. So the left coronary artery you will see in another view. Okay. Then after this, what I would do is to look for the pulmonary veins. So for that, I go for the crab view. So here you see the aorta on the right pulmonary artery and the left pulmonary artery. Okay. And below that is the left atrium here. Right. Below that, below the pulmonary arteries, you see the left atrium. So if I show the probe, so this groove is facing to the right side, and I place it over the sternum and tilt the probe downwards to get this view, right? And when I apply the color Doppler and reduce the flow, you have to reduce the PRF to 33 or something like that. You can see the PRF here. Only if you reduce it, you will be able to see. So here already you are seeing one. This is your one pulmonary vein, right? This is your left lower pulmonary vein. So this is your left upper pulmonary vein. So you've already seen two, left upper pulmonary vein. And then your so this is your right upper pulmonary vein. You can see right upper pulmonary vein and right lower pulmonary vein can be seen at the bottom. So if you're able to see all the four pulmonary veins, that rules out a total anomalous pulmonary venous drainage. So if you look here, so you can see the right lower pulmonary vein is coming in this direction. So I have picked up all the four pulmonary veins. So this is a right lower pulmonary vein. So all the four pulmonary veins are draining into the left atrium. So that is that rules out your total anomalous pulmonary venous drainage. And then you also look for a PDA. So for PDA, what I do is I go to the ductal view. Basically, I go to the right shoulder, and then the probe is somewhere towards the top. And then I just scan and see the aorta. You can see the aortic arch, right, in this view. And then I just adjust in that position and see the left pulmonary artery. One second, the baby is slightly moving. So I increase the PRF, okay. So this is your aorta, and the center round thing is the left pulmonary artery. And if you tilt like this, you will see that. So this blue flow, the one blue flow is the left pulmonary artery, and the other blue flow is the aorta. So left pulmonary artery and aorta, and any flow in between is your PDA. But in this baby, even though the baby was born yesterday, there is no PDA. The PDA is probably closed. No PDA flow, right? So that this is the ductal view, basically, which includes your, you can see the three-legged stool appearance if you have a PDA. And then the next thing you look for is your aorta. So this is the, so aorta, what you do is, you just in the right side of the shoulder, supra sternal area, clavicular area, in this area, with the probe slightly towards the left, you see your aorta. Sometimes you may have to extend the neck a little bit, right? And so you're able to see the aorta here. Can you see the aorta? Yeah. So you see three branches. This is the first branch, second branch, and the third branch. So that confirms your aorta position. The babies don't like the neck being prodded. So that's your aorta. And in the aorta, again, see, again, this is another view to look at the PDA. You can see the left pulmonary artery here. I'll put some color, right? In this view, I'm able to see a small flow, right? This is the left pulmonary artery. And there is a red flash. It's a tiny PDA. So in that other view, I was unable to see a big flow. But in this view, I'm able to see a tiny PDA flow by the side of the left pulmonary artery. Can you see? Right? So that's your the PDA. So this is the left pulmonary artery. The flow here is the aorta, and in between you have the PDA. Okay. So this is a tiny PDA. This may close in the next 24 hours. This is not that significant, you can see here. So a small PDA, and this is the left pulmonary artery flow, and this is the PDA. Okay, and then in the aorta, what you need to do is to ensure that the aortic flow, the aorta, there is no coarctation, right? So in the aorta, what you do is, once you identify the aorta, you look, observe the flow. It should be beautiful and laminar flow. And then you press the pulse wave Doppler or continuous wave Doppler. Right? And then you press the continuous wave Doppler. And you should be able to get beautiful waveforms. These waveforms should not cross 200 centimeter per second, or should not cross 2 meters per second. And there should not be any diastolic tail. All you need to see is the systolic velocity, beautiful separate systolic velocity, and there should not be a tail, diastolic tail. If you see a diastolic tail, that will make you suspicious of a coarctation of aorta, right? So if you approach systematically from your subcostal view, where you look for ASD, your apical view, where you look for VSDs and valves and orientation of the ventricle, then your parasternal view, where you look for TGAs, ventricular septal defect, and all those things, and your aortic view and PDA view, pulmonary vein view, you will cover most of the structural heart diseases. Okay. Now, what I'm going to do is to show some PowerPoint, you know, the videos of common structural heart diseases, right? So this will be a PPT presentation. Okay, what I'll do, I'll share my screen. Now, can you see my screen? Okay, so identification of structural heart disease. So we have to remember that we are all not cardiologists, and functional or screening echocardiogram is what we do. However, whilst doing this, we need to troubleshoot and ask for help. we have to be beware of ego and overconfidence, because when we start learning echo, we do get big-headed and we think that we know more than the cardiologist, and that's the time when we start problems, we start getting into problems. So car, when you're driving, you have to learn to drive it properly. Only practice makes one perfect, and pattern recognition is the important thing. So I told you, you have to watch for subtle clues. So abdominal situs, we have to focus. I told you, the IVC should be above the IVC should be anterior and to the right of the spine. The aorta should be to the left of the spine, and it should be posterior to the IVC. Any abnormal flow between IVC and aorta, you have to focus on direction of flow through the atrial septum, position of the atrial communication. We have to look for any pulsatility of the aorta. We have to watch for diastolic tail. Now, any chamber discrepancy we need to watch, whether the right side of the heart is bigger, left side of the heart is bigger, because whichever chamber is big, we have to remember that there has been more flow during the fetal life. And whichever chamber is small, there has been less flow in the fetal life. And whenever you see a tricuspid regurgitation, don't just say PPHN and say nitric oxide. You have to ask, why is the baby having tricuspid regurgitation? Because sometimes in coarctation of aorta, the baby will have tricuspid regurgitation. And we should not miss that. And the other thing is, the valves should appear and disappear. So during systole, the aortic valve should open, pulmonary valve should open. So that will result in the valve disappearing. And during diastole, the opposite should happen, and that should result in the valves closing. Diagnosis solving, and then try to find the answer. The IVC. And if there is any abnormality, any, our job is to get help, right? Vessels, I showed you can see the XPM. There is a key vessel between the BBC and the IOTA. So you have to suspect whether it's a infraconducting APVC. You can see it's a venous flow, and the Doppler of that vessel suggests that it's a flow. So something is coming there, process here, infracardiac TAPVC. Right? What a bicaval view. So you will be able to see the superior vena cava on the top and the inferior vena cava. The blue color flow is the superior and the inferior vena cava. Blue color flow is the inferior vena cava. And one, the red flow by the is the vertical vein. So all the four pulmonary veins, they form a confluence, and then they form a vertical vein, and then they turn into the inferior vena cava. So,
classic infracardiac TAPVC. On the next one, I told you the position of the intraatrial septum is very, very important. The direction of flow is important. So in this one, the position of the intraatrial system is not in the usual place. It's placed very high above. You know, it's placed very high in the septum. So whenever you don't diagnose it as PFO. And also that you can see pure blue flow in this, right? There is no red flow at all through this atrial septum. So which makes you suspect there's something wrong with the pulmonary veins, right? And you can see in this picture that there is a membrane-like thing on top of the left atrium. And when you put the color Doppler, what's happening is none of the veins are draining into the left atrium. They are forming a confluence and draining into the superior vena cava. Right? So the four pulmonary veins are draining, forming a confluence and
ರಿಟರ್ನ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಿಲ್ಲ ನಮ್ಮ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್ ಇವಾಗ ತೆಗಿಬೇಕಲ್ಲ ಇದೆ
cardiac and all those things you have to be familiar. Here you can see pulsatility of abdominal aorta is not done. And also you can see that the Doppler flow is not very clear. There are some, you know, like speckles. And if you put the Doppler, you can see the diastolic tail. You know, I showed you previously that the descending aorta flow beautiful, only systolic flow should be there. Here you can see the tail. So this would suggest coarctation of aorta. And you can see in this data so here obviously you can see left side of the heart is bigger than the right side. Now all your study is the right side is smaller than the left side. Once you put all the right, and here the aorta axis, you the aorta round with the full rim around. Here what it is, there is the rim really covered on the side. Aorto pulmonary, and this is similar to a large PDA. And whenever this happens, the left side of the heart is overloaded, and the left side of the heart is large. Right now, you can see the poor chamber function. Chamber on the left ventricle is not contracting at all, very poor function, and the intercostal is right. And in the parasternal short axis view, see the top round structure is the pulmonary artery, coronary artery instead of coming from the pulmonary artery. So, short axis parasternal call this as anomalous electrical coronary artery from the pulmonary artery. And when you apply the color, you can see that the coronary left coronary from the pulmonary artery. Okay. So coming, I told you small chamber means reduced flow in the UP. has a very small chamber. And the mitral valve is not opening freely. It is moving, but it's not disappearing in systole and appearing in diastole and all those things. And the left ventricle is very small, right? So, and on top of that, if you look at the ascending, I see the aortic ascending arch is smaller than your descending arch. So, this abnormal mitral valve with proper opening, excited chamber. Called hypoplastic left heart syndrome, right? So this is the, these are the pictures of hypoplastic left heart syndrome. And here, what you see is a right side of the heart, which is very, very small. The tricuspid valve is opening, but it's, it doesn't look normal. The right side of the ventricle is very, very small. The left side appears normal. And here you look at the large round structure in this.
Hello, can you hear me now? I think I got disconnected.
Hello. Yes, hello. Sir, yes, sir.
Can you please tell me which slide, what was the last thing I was showing when I got disconnected?
PAPVC,
okay. What I'll do, I'll try to reconnect again. So TAPVC, okay, I will go back to that. Can you see the screen now?
Yes, sir.
So you saw both intracardiac and supracardiac TAPVC and all those things. Coarctation you haven't seen, right? Okay, I will start from coarctation.
Yes, sir, yes, sir.
Okay. So abdominal aorta, we need to focus. And see, this baby's abdominal aorta is not very pulsatile. And the color Doppler flow is also very spots. And when you put the pulse Doppler, you can see a diastolic tail, right? So normally you should not be able to see the diastolic tail. It should be crisp systole only. And whenever you see a diastolic tail, you suspect a coarctation. And in this video, you can see that the descending arch, there is a bit of a narrowing at the descending arch. And if you put the color Doppler, there is some turbulence in the descending aortic arch. And so this confirms coarctation with abnormal Doppler. And the next one is a chamber enlargement. Here you can see the left side of the heart definitely has a larger chamber, right? Left atrium and the left ventricle. And in this parasternal short axis view, you should have a complete aortic valve ring. But here you can see that the aortic valve ring is not complete. And there is a gap between the aorta and the pulmonary artery. And this you call it as an aortopulmonary window. You can see the Doppler flow across, right? And this is another example of a large chamber. So whenever there is any large chamber, either there is an increased flow in that chamber or there is poor cardiac function. So here there is a very poor cardiac function. And in the parasternal short axis view, you can see that the left coronary artery, it should normally come from the aorta, but here it's coming from the pulmonary artery. So the PA, the structure that is labeled as PA is the pulmonary artery. So this is your anomalous left coronary artery from pulmonary artery. And if you apply color Doppler, you can see the coronary artery flow there. And small chamber suggests that antenatally there had been reduced blood flow in the small chamber. small chamber, here you can see that the left side of the heart is small. The mitral valve is also small and it's not moving that freely. The left ventricle is small and the ascending aorta here is smaller than the transverse aorta and the descending aorta. So this complex of abnormal mitral valve, small LV chambers, and hypoplastic ascending aorta, you call this as hypoplastic left heart syndrome. And then here you can see the right ventricle is very small, right? The right ventricle is very small, the left ventricle is normal. And in the cross-sectional view, you see that the aorta, the round structure, the big structure is the aorta. The one on top of the aorta is your pulmonary artery. The pulmonary artery is very, very small. And the valves are not moving, disappearing and appearing. They are all static, the valves. So a static valve should suspect that there is some problem in the mobility of the valve. And here you suspect whether this baby has pulmonary atresia, confirmed by cardiologist. And small chambers again, here, the right side. See, what you see here is the left ventricle, right? But the right side, the septum, you can see that a very small right side chambers and the tricuspid valve is not opening at all. It is not moving. So this one clearly suggests that there is tricuspid atresia. Now, whenever you see tricuspid regurgitation, see this is the tricuspid regurgitation. You can see the blue flow. It's quite significant tricuspid regurgitation. Always ask why. So here what is happening is, this is the subcostal view. You see your right ventricle and your left ventricle. And the pulmonary valve is very thickened and it is not moving normally. And it is not allowing the blood to go. What you see beyond the pulmonary valve is the duct coming and flowing, not the forward flow. So this baby had critical pulmonary stenosis, right? There was no forward flow beyond the pulmonary artery. So this is critical pulmonary stenosis. And you can see that the velocity in critical pulmonary stenosis, I told you the velocity should not cross more than 2 meters per second. here the velocity is 4.93 meters per second, which is quite significant critical pulmonary stenosis. And we'll also have a look at other cardiac defects. I hope I'm still connected. It looks like okay. Other cardiac, can you hear me, everybody? Hello?
Yes.
Okay, so other cardiac defects. So here, what do we see here is, there is a perimembranous VSD. You can see that the right atrium, right ventricle and the left ventricle at the bottom. And then you can see the interventricular septum. But that interventricular septum is not complete. That interventricular septum is not fully complete. It is defective on top. So any defect on top of the ventricular septum is the perimembranous VSD. On top of that, here you also see that the aorta, instead of coming from the left side of the heart, it is arising above the interventricular septum. This is what we call it as overriding of the aorta, right? So any perimembranous VSD with overriding of this aorta, you call it as tetralogy of Fallot, and ask for a cardiologist to come and confirm. And here, you can see in the parasternal long axis view, see both the vessels, the aortic valve doesn't appear to be normal, and the aortic or the left ventricular outflow tract doesn't appear to be normal. At the same time, you're able to see the pulmonary artery also in this view on the pulmonary valve. But this one looks like, you know, you suspect whether it's a transposition. But here, if you observe closely, both the valves are opening into the same chamber. Both the chambers are opening into the same valve, basically. So this is a truncus arteriosus. So what happens is in truncus arteriosus, you get only one outflow tract with abnormal valves, and both the right ventricle and the left ventricle open into the same outflow tract. And here, this is what I told you. In the parasternal long axis view, you should not be able to see both the vessels simultaneously. Both the vessels, you should not be able to see together. Here you can see clearly two parallel vessels, right? So both the valves are opening and closing in the parallel vessels. So this parallel arrangement, you should always suspect transposition of great arteries and immediately ask for your cardiologist to come and review. And similarly here, I told you the first branch that arises out of the left-sided chamber is your left, it should be your aorta. But here you can see that it looks like an aorta, but it branches at the top. It gives into right and left pulmonary artery. So the vessel that is arising out of the left ventricle here is your pulmonary artery, right? And this confirms your TGA. Okay. And the next one is the interrupted aortic arch. Here you can see the ascending aorta and the transverse aorta flow. But beyond the transverse aorta, you are not able to connect the aorta to the rest of the aorta. And this baby had a very, very large PDA. Right? See, you can see the size of the PDA here. So whenever there is a large PDA, you always suspect there is a reason why nature has kept a large PDA for these babies to survive. So don't just say large PDA, start indomethacin or brufen or paracetamol and go away. Ask, and then you will get an answer. This baby has a large PDA because this baby has an interrupted aortic arch, and the only way the lower limb gets the circulation is through the large PDA. So you can see the three-legged stool appearance here beautifully with the large PDA. And now, commonly we see this atrioventricular septal defect, right? So here, what you see here is, there is a the interatrial septum at the bottom, it is defective. it is not getting connected to the right place. And there is a gap there. And the tricuspid valve and the mitral valve, you know, I told you the tricuspid valve and the mitral valve should not be at the same level, right? The mitral valve is slightly highly placed when compared to the tricuspid valve. So if it's at the same level with the interatrial septum defective at the bottom and with the VSD, you suspect whether that's a common AV valve and an atrioventricular septal defect, right? So this is your atrioventricular septal defect at the bottom. Okay. And the next one, this is a four chamber view. Here you can see that the tricuspid valve is not in its usual place. And the tricuspid valve is very placed at the bottom, very bottom. So this is called as the atrialization of the right ventricle. So this you see in Epstein's anomaly, and this Epstein's anomaly that there will be severe tricuspid regurgitation, right? So this is the one common, one rare anomaly. And aortic stenosis. Sorry, I'm not able to get this video play. So similar to the critical pulmonary stenosis, in the aortic stenosis, there will be turbulence in the left ventricular outflow tract, and the velocity here, it's 3.6 meters per second or 360 centimeters per second. So anything above 200 centimeters per second is abnormal. So this baby has an aortic stenosis. And this is another condition where you screen the heart and then you find a big mass in the left ventricle, causing left ventricular outflow tract obstruction as well here. So this you suspect, you think whether it's a rhabdomyoma and do the necessary investigations and treatment accordingly. So you can see in the left ventricular chamber, this is not a congenital heart disease. You know, it's not a structural heart disease, but the rhabdomyoma develops if the mother has tuberous sclerosis and all those things. And when you're screening for the routine thing, you may find a pericardial effusion. So you can see whenever babies are on, sorry, I'm hearing lots of disturbances. Can you unmute, please?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. One second.
Yeah. So when you're screening, particularly when babies are on parenteral nutrition through a PICC line, and suddenly the baby is getting more frequent DSAPs and bradys than usual, you screen and then see if this baby had a very large pericardial effusion. This is a baby with Down syndrome who also had a transient abnormal myelopoiesis and was having frequent desaturations. And when we did the echo, there was a large pericardial effusion. The previous echo 2-3 days ago was normal, no AVSD or anything, but this one, pericardial effusion developed after that. So this needed drainage. And then dilated heart with poor cardiac function. Recently, we had a mitochondrial cardiomyopathy in a newborn baby. And this baby had a very, very poor function despite inotropes. And you can see the dilated left heart on the paracentral view with very, very poor function despite all inotropes. And then in front of diabetic mothers, they can have septal hypertrophy. And if it's a global hypertrophy, you call it as hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So this child has a very enlarged interventricular septum, suggestive of a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And coming to VSD here, this is quite common. So you see the septum is defective on the top. So basically it's a perimembranous VSD here, right? Whereas in this one, the lower bottom of the lower part of the septum is defective and you can see a flow there. So this is a muscular VSD. So muscular VSDs generally tend to close, and if it's small, whereas perimembranous VSDs, they may not close.
And we also see sometimes babies with cephalococcus infection. We have to make sure that there is the infective endocarditis. Sorry, I'm not able to make this video play. I'll see if I can. Yeah. So you can see on the tricuspid valve, there is a big vegetation sitting there. And this was infective endocarditis. This was a 1.4 kg baby. Unfortunately, we couldn't save this baby because the baby was not fit for surgery due to age and weight. And this embolized and the baby developed a sudden arrest. So this was infective endocarditis. And sometimes when you get the stridor and all those things, you get the vascular ring, pulmonary sling and all those things. Here what is happening is the branch pulmonary arteries are not arising correctly. So the branch pulmonary arteries in your parasternal short axis view, they are abnormal. And also the aortic branches will tell you that if there is any abnormality, right side of the aortic arch, you have to suspect vascular ring and slings if the baby has stridor. And a contrast CT would be ideal in this sort of picture. And this is quite common, the bicuspid aortic valve. So instead of the tri-leaflet, Mercedes-Benz sign, here you get a bicuspid aortic valve. Quite a few of them. Sometimes whenever there is a bicuspid aortic valve, you suspect there is a coarctation as well, because coarctation of aorta, they will also have bicuspid aortic valve. Truncus arterius, as I showed you before. So these are the collections of common congenital heart disease. I think I will stop my presentation here, and I'm open for any suggestions or questions. So I'm happy to take questions or discussions.
Hello, sir. Good afternoon, sir. Could you just tell us the probe position in the crab's view and bicaval view, sir?
Yeah, sure. So in the crab view, one second, I'll show it on the baby itself. Madam. So what I will do, I'll show it on the, how do I turn the screen? Yeah. So this is the baby lying there. And so what I do is, so the probe, the groove should be to the right side, right? So and place the probe on the sternum, right? The upper part of the sternum, and tilt the probe downwards, right? Tilt the probe downwards a little bit, and then you will get the crab view. So if you tilt the probe downwards, you will get the crab view, where you see, so in this view you see your left lower pulmonary vein, right lower pulmonary vein, right, and the right upper pulmonary vein here, the blue one. So this is one more vein you have to get. So this is your, so you can see, in this view you can see one red flow here, one blue flow here, one red flow here, and one blue, all four you can see in this view, right? So this is your crab view to look at all four pulmonary veins, right? On the bicaval view, so what you do is, so you put the probe like a normal, so normal view here, and to see your IVC, you turn. So put the probe, this one has to be on the right side, and you tilt it, rotate the probe downward, right? You rotate the probe downward and tilt the probe upward.
right? And if you do that, I'll show you in the screen. One second. Okay, one second. Okay, so the normal position is what you do is here. Rotate the probe downward so that this groove should be facing the legs, and tilt the probe like this. And what you see here, this is your inferior vena cava, and the one from the top will be the superior vena cava. Right? So this is your bicaval view. So this is your superior vena cava here, inferior vena cava here. This baby, the echo window is not clear. I'll see if I can show it in some other baby. So this is another baby. We'll see whether we have this all. Some of these babies, when they have this feed intolerance and abdominal distension, it is difficult to get the bicaval view, but we'll see. So, like this. And then, one second, the baby is starting to cry. Any quiet baby here? Okay, we'll come. Gauze kudum, gauze and sterile. So I've showed you the crab view. So what I'll do is I'll show you the bicaval view. So place the probe like this, and then rotate the probe and tilt the probe. So here in this screen, you can see the red flow that is coming is the superior vena cava, right? And this is the right atrium, and this one is the left atrium and the interatrial septum, right? So this is the superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, right atrium, left atrium. And if you have a infracardiac TAPVC, you will find a big vessel coming here and getting connected there. Right? So if you put the color Doppler there, see, you see the superior vena cava, you see the inferior vena cava here, and this flow is the interatrial septum, this red flow, and there is no flow here. Right? If you find a big flow there, that is your infracardiac TAPVC. So this is your bicaval view, and the position of the probe is like that. So in this view only I am getting it, and the ridge is facing downward. Okay. Any other questions? Any sir, other questions?
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, how to suspect vein of Galen malformation on echo?
Right, good question. Very, very good question. The question is how to suspect vein of Galen malformation on echocardiogram. So for vein of Galen malformation, what you'll have is you will get a hyperdynamic circulation. So basically on your parasternal long axis view, right, the contractility will be poor. The left side of the heart on the right side of the heart will be dilated, right? So in this view, everything will be tachycardic. The baby will be tachycardic with poor function in your parasternal long axis view. That is one view. And the second thing is, because the vein of the Galen, all the blood vessel is coming from the head, right? The superior vena cava will be dilated. So the flow in the superior vena cava, see, this is your superior vena cava flow. So this is your right atrium here, left atrium there, and your interatrial septum, and the red flow there is your superior vena cava flow. Right? So red flow is superior vena cava flow. Now this is what you usually see, this bit. But if you find a very high flow in the superior vena cava and a very increased flow in the superior vena cava with the velocity, you suspect a vein of Galen aneurysm. And the best way to confirm it is by putting the probe on the head. You put the probe on the head and you diagnose your vein of Galen aneurysm. So you suspect when there is a high output cardiac failure without any cardiac cause. When there is no cardiac cause of failure, then you also suspect vein of Galen. So when I was working at Guy's and St. Thomas, we had 3 vein of Galens in 1 week, all referred for cardiac failure to the cardiologist. So when we scanned, there were no abnormality in the heart. And then except the superior vena cava flow, and when we put the probe on the head, the baby had vein of Galen aneurysm. Any other questions? Any other questions?
Sir, actually not pertaining to the congenital heart diseases. Just when you're calculating the right output, in which view do I have to take the VTI and in which view do I have to take the right ventricle diameter, outflow tract diameter?
Right ventricular outflow tract diameter and the VTI of the right ventricular outflow tract.
Pulmonary artery, when calculating the right ventricular cardiac output.
Okay. Yes, I agree it's not coming into the congenital heart disease, but I'm happy to answer your question. So in which view to take the right ventricular outflow tract VTI and the diameter? Now again, the best view to get the right ventricular outflow tract is either the parasternal long axis view and then tilt it upward, you know, the sweep tilted upward. And in this view, this is a slightly preterm baby, so I'm not able to, so this is your right ventricular outflow tract, and you can see the pulmonary valve opening. This is closed now, the pulmonary valve, and now the pulmonary valve is opening, right? So half centimeter, so when the pulmonary valve is opened, half centimeter, within half centimeter from the pulmonary valve, that is where you have to measure the thing. So what you do is, when the pulmonary valve is opened, so from here to here is your pulmonary artery diameter. But you have to, I'm keeping the pulmonary valve closed so that to show you where it is. But ideally you have to take the measurement when the pulmonary valve is open, right? So that is your one of the best views to get the pulmonary valve diameter. Again, same way you can do it in this view also, in the parasternal short axis view. When the pulmonary valve is opening and closing, right? When the pulmonary valve is opening, within half centimeter from the pulmonary valve, you measure the. And in the same view, you can do the VTI. In the same view, you just below the pulmonary valve, and once you get the ball velocity Doppler. So you go to pulmonary valve here and then select pulmonary valve VTI and then trace it. So basically you trace the So it's roughly 12 centimeter. is your pulmonary valve VTI. So this is where, so both in the parasternal long axis or short axis, that is the best place to visualize the pulmonary valve. You have to do the pulmonary valve VTI. Okay? Any questions? NPO vechirunga red ah irukku distension irukku NPO any other Dinakar sir?
Yes, yes, yes. No, excellent. No, you are teaching. I am just watching. Excellent, excellent. You showed all the views, and even somebody was asking about well and vein of Galen aneurysm. I request everybody, just put the, when you are putting the cardiac probe on the chest, please put it on the AF also to rule out anything, whatever it is. Because just see what is there. It is better. I always teach my students, please go ahead with the AF also, whatever it is. In case if they find something, they are letting us go.
As the Dinakar sir said, I'll put it on the AF, and what we normally do is, you know, we put the color Doppler also and see if there is any abnormal color flow. So normally you see the vessels and anterior cerebral artery and all those things, but any chunky flow in your brain, right, that will suggest a vein of Galen aneurysm. But this baby doesn't have, so I cannot show you. Maybe next time when I talk, I can have pictures of vein of Galen aneurysm. That's a good suggestion. I will keep that in my mind, and I will put a picture of the video of vein of Galen aneurysm that we have picked up. Thank you.
Excellent class.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
And Kamal sir, over to you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Raghav Ramakrishnan, sir. Thanks for joining us. Yeah, it was an initiative we had started basically for our first year DM and DPMP postgraduates, who unfortunately during this pandemic were not able to attend any hands-on training. Otherwise, by now, we had at least two or three hands-on training in echo and point-of-care ultrasonography. And somehow it never happened. So we are finding it difficult to manage certain clinical babies in the emergency room, where usually our PGs are trained. So this has been a boon for these postgraduates to at least start the process of doing functional echo at the bedside. So yes, thank you so much, sir, for joining us. And I should thank our Professor Dinakar to have called you and convinced you to join us. It was very, very informative. And now it's up to the postgraduates to do it at the bedside and learn more and more and clear their doubts as the this thing classes continue. We are having these classes for till about mid-October, sir. So we'll be happy if you join us whenever you get time. It's usually on a Tuesday and a Friday. So we have two classes per week, Tuesdays and Fridays. And it has been going quite strong from 1st of September. I think we have covered we have almost covered six classes. Without any interruption. I should thank Professor Dinakar for this commitment. Without any interruption. In fact, I had to leave early to a last class. But sir has been right on time, continuing and going beyond even 4 o'clock to teach our students. Thank you, sir.
So, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much for
next class
inviting me.
Yeah, yeah, no problem. Next class will be from Dr. Prashant Gowda. It is a normal views of the brain. Views of the brain. So he is an excellent teacher too, number one. That next class, so Tuesday, that next class will be Friday, normal variants of the brain. That is so important, because sometimes otherwise you people will tell, oh, this is an abnormality, comment something. All those things, next two classes will be very, very, very important for all the neonatologists.
Okay.
So I request everybody to participate. Over to Kamal sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thanks. I thank all the participants who have joined. I hope you are all benefited. And once again, a great thanks to our sir, Professor Dr. Ramakrishnan and Professor Dinakar sir. And also Dr. Prashant. Yes. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you everybody for inviting me, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Today party.